let's move on to the next slide. And some of this stuff, this is on my studio, Nerdville, USA, and play on the Hitsville, USA. Let's go to the other one. And then this one is also on the house. Now this is, again, on the house.
Tell them about the kitchen. Now this is really sick.
We're gonna get to the kitchen. And this sign I bought from Chris Isaac. And he had it on stage as part of a prop. He was doing like a Sun Records tribute show. And my friend Rick Gould said he was down at Chris Isaac's storage locker. And he says, yeah, Chris has got a few cases for sale. But he's got this Memphis recording sign. It's really big. I don't know what you're gonna do. And I go, I'll take it. So we get it, and I'm looking, and I go, it's huge. And I go, Rick goes, what are we gonna do with it? And I go, hang it on the house. And we hang it on the house. 2 years later, I see Chris Isaac on an airplane flying from LA to Nashville, Tennessee. And I'm in the seat right next to him. I don't know Chris from you know, Christopher Cross. I don't know. And I lean over and go, excuse me, Mr. Isaac, I'd just like to thank you for selling me your Memphis recording sign. And he looks at me like, oh man, I really should have brought the bodyguard with me today. Yeah. And he goes, what Memphis recording sign? I go, your old stage prop. And he goes, oh, you bought that? And I go, yeah, it's great. And I'm like telling him, I get all enthused. And I'm like, yeah, I hung it on the house. And he just looked at me, and he has one word, and he goes, why? Why not? So Norm was at my house a couple of weeks ago, and I redid my kitchen, and it was just something, you know, I wasn't very good at, and I had this idea about what to do with the kitchen cabinets. I said, what do you do with kitchen cabinets? Like, cabinets are cabinets. And I said, well, let's think outside of the box. And I had the cabinets made out of the same wood as they made these flying V's. You can go to the next slide. I think it's the next one.
You know, there are electric shock treatments that could maybe straighten
this. Right. Oh, before we get to that, this sign here, that's in the backyard. And I bought that from a guy who borrowed it from the city of Fullerton, California. And that's the actual intersection of Fender Ave and State College where Leo's original factory was. And he goes, hey, do you want the Fender Road sign from Fullerton? And I go, you bet your ass I do.
You better hope these people like you, because if they call the city, you could be doing some time.
Yeah. It is the most illegal thing that I own. And we went to Home Depot and got some cement and a pole. And I dug the pole, and I had my slippers on and a shovel, and we dug the pole and got my level, my straight edge out, because I'm like super OCD about everything being straight, and sat there. And basically, for an hour and a half, made sure that thing's straight. And it looks absolutely wonderful in the backyard. And
I know nothing about this kind of stuff. You know, I don't really want to do any time at my age.
Let's go to the next slide. Let me introduce a few things. Okay, these are the Nerdville Converse that my brother-in-law and my sister made for me for Christmas. We can go to the next slide. And now this is what we're talking about, the kitchen cabinets. What, from afar, it looks like an innocent drawer handle. To me, I see a Carina cabinet, just like the Flying V, and I see a Les Paul tailpiece masquerading as a drawer handle. Oh, please don't clap for that. And that's how I choose to live. And I have this man to thank, because every time, you know, I walked into your shop, there's always something killer, there's always this, like, you know, there's always these great guitars and everything, and then you take, you know, the back room and I see all the really, like, exceptional stuff. And so the thing is, how do you find all this stuff? I mean, because what I always tell people is, like, you have to really find the first one, and then the second one finds you.
Well, I think, you know, what happened is people used to think of me as being crazy and a nut, paying too much money for, like, really exceptionally rare guitars. I think that's how they find you now, too, so.
Well, you know, the thing is that you sold me a guitar named Amos, and right. It was the Amos R5. I think if you go to the next slide, I think that's it. Oh, no, that's actually my, that's my music room. That's where I sit in self-loathing, and I look around, and I say, this is what happens when there's no authority figure to say no and please stop. Anyway, sold me a guitar named Amos that you had for 40 years. Thank you very much. We talked about it last year, and it was it's a 58 Flying V.
Much like this one.
Much like this one. And we were just talking about the concept of, like, the first one, you have to find it. You know, I asked you, and I said, hey, listen, Norm, I know you have an old Flying V. I know it's real because you have it. And, you know, would you ever consider selling it? And you were gracious enough to do that. About a year and a half later, I'm driving this Nerdville mobile from Seattle to Los Angeles. And this woman, basically was in charge of cleaning out her uncle's house. And her name was Tara Williams. And her mother was in her 80s. Her uncle, whose name was Gino Landry, was a gospel musician. And he played guitar and he played saxophone with people, everyone from gospel, you know, touring gospel acts to Lightning Hopkins he played. And so he passed away in March of last year. And Tara was in charge of making, you know, settling the estate. So she takes Gino's saxophone to a local music store. I still can't figure out which one it is. And sells the saxophone to the store. The next day, she brings in a brown gig bag from the 70s with that, the top of it was cut out, so the top of this would stick out. And it's a Gino on it. And she brings it in, she pulls the guitar out, and the tuners had crumbled, and it was dusty and rotten. And she goes, I'd like to sell this. And the store looks at her and says, we don't deal in that kind of used guitar. Try Guitar Center.
And how much did she want for the guitar, by the way?
She was going to sell this. She was prepared to sell this guitar for $500 or less. This is March of last year. She walks into the Guitar Center, and I know Nick Conti, who's the head buyer there, and he calls me on this kind of behavior. ring up the attic, he's there. And we were in Barstow, Northern California, and he says, look at the pictures I just sent you. And I'm like, are you kidding me? You know, like, these don't just show up every day.
There's 91 of these, and most of them probably are destroyed. Who knows
what. Spoken for. And so I go, where is it? Because it's in Sacramento. If you want to come see it with me, I'll fly up. I'm like, no, I'm actually 2 hours away. So the next day we meet, 1 o'clock at Guitar Center. We're waiting, and it's now 2:30, 3 o'clock. I'm like, well, I got to drive 6-7 hours in a 34 Ford, which is not exactly reliable. It's leaking.
There's another car that he has that's not too reliable.
No, that broke down in front of the store. And so basically, around 3 o'clock, Tara walks in with this in a gig bag, and this old thing, old wedge-shaped guitar comes out, and I was like, wow, that you could live 2 collecting lifetimes and not see something like that. So we kind of like have to explain to her that this, if you've ever wanted to be on Antiques Roadshow, this is your moment, Tara, because, you know, it's worth a lot more. And so we paid her fare, and
this, how much is this guitar?
This guitar is insured for $450,000. I'll be throwing it overboard after. I would never. But this guitar is insured for $450,000. It's just so rare. But the thing is, I played it last night outside. I play it in here. I play it every night. I play Amos every night. I play all these type of guitars because if they're just gonna sit in a glass case, I don't need to own them. You know, I'd rather see somebody play it.
And by the way, the lady would have taken $500. How much did she end up with?
She ended up with $200,000. And so this is the best part of the story. I played the guitar on Conan O'Brien last summer after I got it, and I texted her and I said, Tara, just so you know, I'm on the Conan O'Brien show. Thank you, Conan, for being the only national television show ever to have my band in the history of my life on the thing. And it took them 35 albums and whatever. It's because I'm ice cold in the media. That's I know. Anyway, I texted her and she texted me right back. Oh, that's great news. In September, the end of September comes up. Now, we moved mountains to get her the money. And people flew in and you know, we helped her out. Moved mountains to get her away. This is 4 or 5 months after the fact, after I bought it. We're playing Sacramento. I reach out again. Tara, this is Joe. I have your uncle's Flying V with me. I'd like to invite you and your mother out to my show and, you know, buy you guys dinner and blah, blah, blah. And about 3 minutes after I sent the text, she gets back to me. Who is this?
You know, us senior citizens, we forget our, you know.
And I go, it's Joe Bonamassa. I bought your uncle's Flying V. I know that happens every day of your life. You know, you're easily confused with the other guys. Never heard back. Like, I was like, sorry.